What's going on, guys? It's Danny from Fantasy Stock Exchange here, bringing you another installment of the Waiver Wire series I am running currently on the Fantasy Stock Exchange channel. So if you guys have watched any of these Waiver Wire videos before, I basically tell you who to put your bids on and what order I would rank them slash how much I would bid on them slash if I would use the number one waiver claim for them. So if you guys are new, again, make sure you go check out the other installments just to kind of get an idea of the format of these videos. Basically give you a couple quarterbacks, running backs, receivers, tight ends, with a couple honorable mentions mixed in there as well. So guys, week 8 football, NFL season is finally done. So leave a comment down below what your NFL team's record is, because it's hopefully better than mine. I mean, my Dallas Cowboys are 2-6 right now. Season's basically already gone for them. But hey, unless you're a Jets, Giants, Jaguars fan, team's probably doing a lot better than that. So make sure you go comment down below what your NFL team's current record is. And yeah, just an exciting week of football. Definitely saw some huge games, as you guys would have saw in the recap show, with Bush. I mean, Davante Adams, Dalvin Cook, huge fantasy football performances. So hopefully you're on the winning end of that and not facing against them. Fingers crossed. But yeah, just going to be talking about the top waiver wire claims again going into week 9. So it's crunch time. You're going to need to make these depth pieces, guys, that you're going to have to lean on down the stretch. And there's a couple of nice options on the waiver wire this week. So hopefully you guys could pick them up, help you make that final playoff push, get you in that top 6 or top 4, whatever your current league basically needs in order to make the playoffs. But before we get into that, you can hit the intro. Okay, so as I mentioned, we're going to start off with the quarterback position, the top week 9 waivers at the quarterback position. And it starts off with the quarterback for the Denver Broncos in Drew Locke, currently at 10% ownership in Yahoo League. So just recapping or rehashing his week 8 stat line against the Los Angeles Chargers, you see 248 passing yards, 3 passing touchdowns with 1 interception, and 2 carries for -1 yard. So if you're actually looking at the overall day in 4-point passing touchdown leagues, would equate to 19.82 fantasy points. So looking at his week 9 matchup, he goes up against the Atlanta Falcons. Well, we know what the Atlanta Falcons are at this point. They are a 2-6 football team that struggles defensively to the tune of giving up the most fantasy points to the quarterback's position so far this year. So again, gloss over his stats, but he's coming off a quality performance in the last second win that the Broncos had this week against the Los Angeles Chargers. I mean, Drew Locke is just poised to keep building. And the matchup, again, as I mentioned, against the Falcons, is just basically one that you would hand pick as a fantasy football match manager to exploit. So if you need to rely on him as a streamable option, I think he can give you top baseline, top 15 to 20 type numbers for this week, and you should be able to expect some high quarterback to production. And again, if you're desperate at the position, you need a streamer for the week, I mean, put $2 or so on him. He can get you through for the week. Again, a lot of bye weeks this week. If you have, like, I don't know, off my head, Carson Wentz maybe, you can definitely pick up a guy in Drew Locke who can give you some decent value off the waiver wire. So talking about, again, potential FAAB bid, I would say roughly around $2. Wouldn't go too much more than that because there's a couple other options I wouldn't mind. But yeah, $2 should be able to get it done. Go lock up Lock. I mean, that matchup is phenomenal, gorgeous. I mean, salivating. But yeah, going into the number 2 pickup at the quarterback position, and that's going to be Derek Carr, quarterback from the Las Vegas Raiders, currently at 42% ownership in Yahoo League. So again, not really anything to write home about in his week 8 win against the Cleveland Browns. So at Cleveland, bad weather conditions, but he put up 112 passing yards, 1 touchdown, no interceptions, but also had a little bit on the ground. I mean, 6 carries for 41 rushing yards. But again, if you started him, 12.58 fantasy points in 4-point leagues isn't really anything to write home about. I understand that, but keep in mind in terms of context, the weather was disgusting in that game. So talking about week 9, I actually mentioned how well Drew Locke was able to perform against this defense, but week 9, the Las Vegas Raiders, actually go up against the Los Angeles Chargers in Los Angeles. A lot of Los Angeles right there. But again, as I mentioned with Drew Locke, he was able to absolutely carve up that defense last week. I mean, The Chargers have just been conceding a ton of fantasy points to the position, similar to the Atlanta Falcons. Again, the Chargers give up the third most fantasy points to the quarterback position thus far. And I just think Carr's primed to bounce back from that outing, if you will, against the Cleveland Browns. Again, that was largely affected by weather. I don't really take too much from the overall volume of the day from anybody in that Raiders offense. So people who are harping on, I don't know, Rashard Higgins, Kareem Hunt, or Henry Ruggs, like overall in that matchup, regardless, I wouldn't really take too much out of it because, again, it was a low volume, mucky type 16-6 win for the Raiders. So when you're talking about Derek Carr, he's just played solid overall as a quarterback this year. He's ranked in the top 20. The Raiders have a 4-3 record. And again, that matchup is so juicy. I just feel confident that if I put Carr into my lineup, he'll give you that top 20 type ability, and you should be fine with having him in your lineup again. So talking about bid, maybe $2 should be able to get it done, similar to Drew Lock. I do think that Carr would be a more steady option this week, while Locke may have a higher ceiling. So it all depends if you're streaming the quarterback position, what you're kind of looking for in this week. But yeah, I think either will be fine options and will ultimately be top 20 quarterbacks for the week. So talking about honorable mentions, this is a little bit more of a long-term type option, and that's going to be Tua Tagovailoa, quarterback from the Miami Dolphins, currently at 32% ownership in Yahoo League. So again, nothing to glance over in his first NFL career start. I mean, it was a low-volume performance against the Rams. I mean, he only had 93 passing yards. But when you're looking at Tua Tagovailoa, the reason why I'm excited in being able to pick him up, the potential and the situation for the Bama rookie is just sky high. I mean, you got weapons all over the offense. That defense is just not going to score two touchdowns every single game. So when that comes back to down to earth, I mean, let's be honest here. The game script in that game against the Rams was just something that no quarterback's going to put up a ton of volume when your defense is scoring two touchdowns, the other offense on the field basically the majority of the game. I mean, the game scripts are going to improve for Tua. He's going to be able to get you more volume. And ultimately, with those weapons, he can supplement top 20 quarterback production for the rest of the year. So this is more of a longer-term type play, but definitely one that can pay off in spades, in my opinion, with Tua Tagovailoa for the honorable mention. Segueing. Running back position, the meat and potatoes, as I like to refer to it in the fantasy football landscape. Again, if you don't have running backs, especially in a year like this where they're dropping like freaking hotcakes, you're just not going to be able to contend. Well, an option that can really give you a solid floor in terms of overall volume this week, and my number one waiver wire running back, is going to be Damien Harris, running back from the New England Patriots. Currently just in that if you will, range that I look for in waiver pickups, just under 50%. He's currently at 47% ownership in Yahoo League. So if you're looking at his week 8 stat line against the Buffalo Bills, 16 attempts, 102 rushing yards, and a rushing touchdown. Again, he's not going to give you a lot in the receiving game in general. We kind of know that with New England running backs. They have specific roles. Again, they're going to have their grinder, which is basically what Damien Harris is. They're going to have their receiving back, which is basically what James White is. And then their multi-purpose type back would be Rex Burkhead. But in a matchup week 9 against the New York Jets, they are going to lean on their grinder and what should be a total bounce back performance for the Patriots. Again, you're talking about a team in the New York Jets that have allowed the 8th most points to the running back position. And the Patriots are just coming off four straight game losing streak. Do you really think Bill Belichick, that overall veteran presence of that team, is going to let them lose 5 in a row and give the 0-8 Jets their first win? I mean, to me, this is just an absolute smash matchup for Harris here. We're talking about overall type of expectation for Harris, given the ultimate available volume in this game. Except, again, I expect the Patriots to be up early, up big, be able to grind that clock out for this team. I do think Damien Harris can see upwards of 20, 22 type carries in this game. And if that's the case, I mean, expect him to give you at minimum high-end RB3 type production for this week. Again, this former Bama thumper is going to get fed the ball in a prime matchup. If you need him to flex right away, right this week, I wouldn't even be opposed to giving, 15 to 20 type FAAB bucks, even maybe more at this current point, given how late we are into the season. If you need to spend your budget on him, I'm fine if you need a flex play for the week. But Ideally, I would say around 50 to 20 bucks, but if you have to bid more and you need a flex for this week in a must-win situation with bye weeks, I am fine with bidding more than that. But overall baseline, 15 to 20. Next running back for the waiver wire, I'm actually going to be talking about Cam Akers, running back from the Los Angeles Rams, currently at 31% ownership in Yahoo League. So again, the overall stat line against the Miami Dolphins wasn't overly impressive. Again, 9 attempts, 35 rushing yards with a target that he caught for 19 receiving yards. He does have his bye this week, which is kind of a negative, if you will. But to me, Cam Akers has just looked like the player we all expected him to be coming out of Florida State. I mean, he totaled 54 total yards from scrimmage on the 10 touches he received. He's looked efficient. He's looked elusive in the open field on those touches. I mean, if you guys were able to see, I don't want to nitpick one play, but if you were able to see that reception that he had against the Miami Dolphins, he basically made four guys miss, where it was absolutely fantastic, looked good in the open field. I mean, that's just the type of element that Cam Akers brings as a player. If you're Sean McVay and you know that Daryl Henderson is dealing with that thigh injury, we don't necessarily know his status coming out of the bye. Why would you not give a guy in Cam Akers more volume, more opportunity to shine as your second round rookie pick? Now, I'm not going to just ignore the red flags with this pickup. I understand there is a ton of risk in picking up Cam Akers. You don't necessarily know what his role is going to be. They still have Darrell Henderson, who they have leaned on when he's been healthy. Even Malcolm Brown has been able to receive more touches overall than Cam Akers. This is a type of FAAB pickup, if you will, where you spend 10 to 15 bucks on the upside play of Cam Akers, see what you kind of have with him, and if he is able to gain the role that we all hope and dream for Cam Akers, he's going to be able to return rest of season low-end RB2 type value if he's able to garner that role. So again, this is a very risky long-term type play, but if you're 5-3, 6-2, you're able to afford a end-of-the-bench type stash with ultimate huge upside, I would absolutely spend the FAAB in being able to lock up a guy in Cam Akers because he's just that talented and the opportunity is just that great if he is able to seize it. So definitely love Cam Akers. Go after him if you need that longer-term type stash. So talking about honorable mentions at the running back position, we saw Zach Moss really pop off this weekend, 85 rushing yards, 2 rushing touchdowns. Again, he's a nice option in my opinion. But the reason why he didn't crack the top two at the position is the backfield to me is still a split. And it's going to be in a limited opportunity on a week-to-week basis, given how involved Josh Allen is in the red zone in terms of scoring a bunch of rushing touchdowns. So keep an eye on that. Another guy I kind of like is Gus Edwards at 30%. Again, the reason why he's not on it as well, he only played 33% of the snaps playing second fiddle to Dobbins, but the clear in-between the tackles, goal line type role that Mark Ingram has vacated is ultimately give Gus Edwards a huge role in this offense beside J.K. Dobbins. By the way, if J.K. Dobbins was owned in less than 50% of the leagues, I would be advising you right the hell now to bid your whole FAAB on him. But doesn't meet the threshold, so he's not going to be featured on this video. So if you guys are wondering why I'm not talking about J.K. Dobbins, mostly it's because he doesn't meet the threshold. So final honorable mention running back is going to be Jordan Wilkins at 3% ownership. Again, he's the third most elusive running back according to PFF. And with the Jonathan Taylor injury, it just opens a potential door for Wilkins to end up receiving more volume. So definitely keep an eye out on what the status is of Jonathan Taylor. If he misses time, I mean, Jordan Wilkins can definitely give you RB3 type production in that role. So he's looked good. He's looked efficient. He's actually looked better than Jonathan Taylor has this year. So I definitely wouldn't be shocked if Jordan Wilkins was able to perform if Jonathan Taylor was to miss any time with that apparent injury that Frank Reich actually addressed after the game. So moving on from the honorable mentions at the running back, I'm actually going to be talking about the top wide receiver claims of the week. And it starts off with none other than Corey Davis, wide receiver from the Tennessee Titans at 48% ownership. Looking over his week 6 stat line against the Bengals, 8 receptions on 10 targets for 128 receiving yards and 1 touchdown. I mean, this is the type of day that we expected from A.J. Brown. Me and Bush both had him as our wide receiver 2 on the week. This is what we expected, and it just so happened to come from Corey Davis. So if you're looking at week 9, again, he does go up against the Chicago Bears. Kind of a negative matchup, if you will. They've only given up the third least points to the position. They're very stingy in that regard. But, I mean, Corey Davis has just absolutely shown something to start off this season. I mean, you just haven't been able to see the consistency from him week to week in his NFL career. And then all of a sudden this year, I mean, every single game he's played, he's been productive. He's averaged 13.88 PPR points per game. Or sorry, half PPR points per game, actually. My bad. 74 receiving yards per game and 3 touchdowns in the 5 games he's played. Heck, he's been the ultimate wide receiver 2 to A.J. Brown. And he's crossed over 11.1 half PPR points in 4 of the 5 games he's played. So, I mean, at this point, given the consistency, given the floor that he's shown, to me, he's just a high floor wide receiver 3 at the minimum, regardless of matchup. I mean, he's got 10 targets the past 2 weeks. You're not accustomed to seeing Corey Davis be referred to as a consistent player. But, I mean, give credit where credit's due. He's been playing like that all season, and it's time that we really stop fading this guy because, I mean, he's proven the talent. He's proven the consistency. He's proven the trust that he has with Ryan Tannehill. If you need a wide receiver 4 on your team, again, I think he can give you a high floor wide receiver 3 rest of the year. So if you have 35, 40 type FAAB budget available, definitely spend it on Corey Davis because I do think he can give you value rest of the season. So again, Corey Davis is more of a high floor play in my opinion. I think he's going to be solid rest of the season. May not have league winning type upside, but you plug him in your flex, he's going to get the job done. No questions asked. The guy I actually have is a high ceiling league winner type, if you will, receiver that's currently available in 76% of leagues. Again, he's only owned in 24% of Yahoo leagues. It's going to be Jalen Reagor, wide receiver from the Philadelphia Eagles. So week 8 against my beloved Dallas Cowboys. He actually caught 3 passes on 6 targets for only 16 receiving yards and a touchdown. Also had a carry for 6 yards. So week 9, he does have his bye week. So again, glossing over the overall game he had against my Dallas Cowboys. In the first game of action since week 2, Reagor actually performed decent given the circumstances. I mean, Carson Wentz was absolutely struggling in this game. Yet Reagor still received 6 targets. He caught a touchdown. And this is a game where Wentz passed for 123 passing yards, 2 interceptions, and 2 fumbles lost. I mean, this is just a miserable game from his quarterback that you're just not going to see on a week-to-week basis. Even with all that, on the 27 total passing attempts that Carson Wentz had, he still targeted this talented rookie 6 of those times. That's a positive outlook for a rookie coming off an injury in his first game back. So, I mean, he looked good. He looked efficient despite the poor play. And as we expect further progress from Wentz kind of getting over this terrible game, if you will, I just think that the chemistry we can see evolving with Jalen Reagor could ultimately be keeping on improving for the rest of the season. So they have week 9. They have their bye week this week to gain that rapport, to gain that level of trust between those two. And I do think that after week 9 bye, week 10 and on, Reagor can give you a potential high upside wide receiver 3 for the rest of the season, given the opportunity. Again, the floor of this is ultimately going to be low. I acknowledge that. But if Reagor hits, who's saying he can't be not similar to Fulgham, but maybe just a little bit less than Fulgham? And Fulgham's been a wide receiver 1 for the season since he stepped up for the Eagles. So, I mean, again, he's going to operate as the 1B or 2, if you will, behind Fulgham. But there's just so much available volume in this offense to be absorbed with the injuries of all those offensive weapons they had. Again, Deshaun Jackson going down. Alshon Jeffery not even looking like he's going to play. Zach Ertz getting hurt. Miles Sanders being banged up. I mean, there's just so much available volume for this offense for the Philadelphia Eagles. Ultimately, Reagor could have a consistent role as soon as week 10 when they come off the bye. So if you're talking about FAAB potential, again, $30 maybe able to get it done, $25 maybe if you want to be stingy. But the risk versus reward at this current point in fantasy football, if you can hit on a potential league winner down the stretch in a guy like Jalen Reagor, it's ultimately going to be such a valuable play for you given the amount of injuries on the landscape. So honorable mention, I kind of want to brief over before we get into tight ends. Tim Patrick, wide receiver from the Denver Broncos. He's just been consistently good since the injury to Cortland Sutton. Again, he's kind of similar in a way in terms of consistency to what we've kind of seen from Corey Davis at a lesser value or a lesser scale, if you will. A couple other guys I want to mention, 2 rookies. Denzel Mims, wide receiver from the New York Jets, was actually able to get 42 receiving yards in the past 2 games. not a whole lot, but if they want to get the talented rookie the ball over the stretch in what's ultimately going to be a rebuilding type year, I can definitely see him flourishing as a maybe wide receiver 5 for you down the stretch, depth receiver for you down the stretch so you can flex in positive matchups. And Darnell Mooney, I mean, he's just such a talented wide receiver operating behind Allen Robinson. There's just such a clear role to be able to garner. I mean, we expected it to be Anthony Miller, but Darnell Mooney has just looked like the better player thus far. So if you can get it for cheap, a couple bucks, stash him at the end of your bench. Maybe he has a more consistent role down the stretch. Darnell Mooney has looked fantastic thus far. So hopefully he gets hit on a couple more long bombs because realistically he's been missed so often in that offense. I mean, don't tell Bush, but he kind of cooked the Bucks, but they just didn't hit him. Anyways, let's move on to the tight end position while I get off topic. And that's going to be Jordan Reed, tight end from the San Francisco 49ers. Currently only at 3% ownership in Yahoo leagues. Again, he doesn't have any available week 8 stats. Why? Because he has not played since week 3. Now, his week 9 matchup against the Green Bay Packers. Green Bay is currently the 4th stingiest defense to the tight end position. I understand. It's a tough matchup. While the matchup is tough on Thursday night against the Matt LaFleur-led Green Bay Packers, I mean, just the way the 49ers use the tight end position in this Kyle Shanahan offense, it just gives me so much excitement over what Jordan Reed could potentially be for the rest of 2020 with the recent news of George Kittle expected to miss the next 8 weeks with a broken foot. If Jordan Reed is operating at 100%, which granted, he never really is, I mean, he totaled 14 targets in weeks 2 and 3 prior to exiting with the injury. The injury concern is always going to be there with Jordan Reed. I understand that. But when he's healthy, he is shown to be one of the best receiving talents the position has ever seen. Like, he's one of the most athletically dominant tight ends the league has ever seen. It's just, it's unfortunate this guy has never been able to stay healthy. So the upside is the roof. If you need an upside play at tight end in a position that really lacks a lot of upside outside maybe the top 3 or 4 type options, I mean, Jordan Reed could be an absolute league winner down the stretch if he's able to stay healthy. Again, fingers crossed. I know he's injury prone. I get that. But if you can make a splash $8 to $10 bid on a guy who, if he stays healthy in that role, can give you top 5 type production, you do it. You do it at a position as scarce as tight end. This is the ultimate lottery ticket. He can completely bust on you. I get it. But if you hit gold. Next tight end. Obviously a lot less exciting than what Jordan Reed's potential is. But Eric Ebron's just solid, man. Again, week 8 against the Baltimore Ravens. 4 receptions on 5 targets for 48 receiving yards and a touchdown. In week 9. He's on the road against my Dallas Cowboys again. The Dallas Cowboys are currently a league average defense, if you will, against the tight end position. Well, let's not get it twisted. I mean, this defense as a whole allows over 33 points per game, which is by far the most in the league for the record. Ebron has shown thus far that he's just an involved piece in that Pittsburgh offense, in an offense that is that has the 7-0 Steelers absolutely rolling team. So, I mean, this is just going to be a shellacking. The 7-0 Steelers are going to go on the road against my 2-6 Cowboys and blow the fucking roof off of AT&T Stadium. So, Ebron has a real shot at getting 5-plus targets in 6 of his last 7 games. If he does it on this upcoming Sunday against the Cowboys, it will have been in 6 of the last 7 games. That's what you look for from the tight end position. A guy who's athletically gifted, which Ebron is, and is involved in his offense, which Ebron has shown to be. The only real stinker he's had in that range just so happens to be the Browns on that resume. So take it for what you will, but Ebron has just been consistently involved week to week. And again, he could definitely reach the end zone again against the Cowboys. I mean, the Cowboys just can't stop a nosebleed. Ebron has shown over his career that he is a touchdown machine when he's relied upon in that area. So, I mean, Pittsburgh's going to put up plenty of points. I would not be surprised if Ebron scoring maybe 1 or 2 touchdowns in this game. So talking about FAAB, I said $8 to $10 for Jordan Reed, maybe $5-6 for Eric Ebron, if you will, just because he has a safer floor. Honourable mentions at the position probably would only really be Logan Thomas, tight end from the Washington football team, currently at 21% ownership. Again, you got to nitpick at this current point, but when it comes to Logan Thomas, I mean, he's just so involved in that offense that you just can't ignore it. I mean, And to be fair, the big knock on Logan Thomas prior to these last couple of weeks is he's gotten the targets. He's gotten the targets. He just has not been efficient with them. Well, these last 2 weeks with Kyle Allen under center, he's actually been decently quietly efficient, if you will. Again, week 8, I understand his bye, but those 2 weeks prior, he ended up scoring 11.7 half PPR points and 14 half PPR points in those back-to-back games. I mean, I already mentioned the involvement. 5.7 targets per game or a 91 target pace for a tight end is just absolutely absurd, operating as the number two weapon ultimately on the offense behind Terry McLaurin. And if you want to throw Antonio Gibson in there as well, I understand that. So I mean, given the rapport and the connection we've seen between Kyle Allen and Logan Thomas, I would absolutely be willing to throw a $3 to $5 type bid and see what I got with Logan Thomas for the rest of the year, because he's played well since the benching of Dwayne Haskins. So again, yeah, $3 to $5 should be able to get it done there. Ending off the video though, if you guys made it this far, make sure you go leave that like button on the video. Go support us at FSC. Really means a lot. Just cracking about, we're almost at the 2,100 subscriber mark. So really appreciate you guys continuing the support. Again, if you're new to the channel, make sure you hit that like button. Comment down below, as I mentioned, what the record is of your favorite team. And if you're just seeing this and you're recommended, seeing a whatever, an Italian guy with a fucking bandana, hit that subscribe button. You're going to see Bush come out later in the week. You're going to see Mikey come out. You're going to see us on the live streams. It's definitely an enjoyable experience for you guys. So don't take my word for it. Just experience it on your own right. So finally, I'm going to end off the video with defense / special team streamers, if you will. And there's three main ones on the docket this week, in my opinion, and two of them are actually playing against each other in the same game. So we'll start off with the individual defense, if you will. And that's going to be the Tennessee Titans going on the road against the Chicago Bears. So they're currently at 48% ownership. Again, we know what the Bears are at this point. They're kind of just a mess of an offense that kind of, if you will, I don't want to say gets carried by their defense, but it just seems like they're always in slug fights rather than just blowing teams out in the offensive end. Tennessee Titans are a really talented defense overall, so I do think they're going to be able to put up points, put up sacks against a depleted offensive line for the Bears. And then you're talking about the other two streamable matchups. I'm going to actually be talking about the Washington football team defense going up against Daniel Jones in the New York Giants offense, currently at 60% ownership. Again, any defense that's starting as Daniel Jones, you start them, plain and simple. And finally, the reverse of that, the Giants defense going up against the football team and Kyle Allen. Yes, he had a good, efficient game against my Dallas Cowboys, but a lot of quarterbacks, except for Carson Wentz, are going to be able to do that. So Giants defense currently 11% ownership. I definitely consider them against Kyle Allen, who has proved to turn the ball over whenever he's given a chance to really start in game. So yeah, glossing over the week 9 waivers. Hope you guys enjoyed the video. And again, guys, good luck in your fantasy football matchups. Hopefully we are able to help you out so far this year. And stay tuned for later videos this week, especially that rankings video that should be coming out on Saturday for you guys. But until then, I'll see you. Peace out.